So, welcome back to Applied Mathematical Finance. We have specified our discrete forward rate model. So the model that was formerly known as LIBOR market model. So we have a fairly general formulation that allows many different parameters. We have fairly general volatility function. We model all the forward rates under a common measure. So we have for all the forward rates an instantaneous correlation function. Yeah, so actually a correlation matrix of such correlation functions. Of course, every forward rate has its initial value. And there was one thing left, which is here the drift. So how do we determine the drift function? And I already mentioned that when we were discussing the quanto. Here in modeling interest rates, you see that actually the change of numerator or the choice of numerator and associated with is the choice of the measure, so the change of the measure, is really a very helpful technique. And therefore, I will at least derive the drift under two different measures, because also these measures have different numerical properties. Yeah? So while when we were discussing about the analytic models, we saw very clearly that sometimes a special choice of measure made it easier to derive an analytic formula. So it was just our laziness. Yeah? That was a bit the motivation that we could much easier write down the formula under this measure. Here it has also a meaning for the numerical method, for example, for the accuracy of the Euler scheme, of the Euler discretization, or the Monte Carlo convergence rate, when we choose different measures. So that's a nice thing, and we will have a numerical experiment on this. We already had this derivation of the drift, and the scheme how we derived the drift was more or less always the same. So we would like to move now to an equivalent martingale measure. So we choose some numerator, and for that numerator we would like to see the drift under the equivalent martingale measure. Well, that's the nice thing of the Gersanov theorem. We do not need to determine the measure, because Gersanov just tells me changing the measure is a change of the drift under certain assumption. Yeah, so for example, my volatility function is positive. Then it's enough to just derive the shape of the drift. Okay, and the drift is characterized by the property that under my equivalent martingale measure, all relative prices, so V divided by N, are martingales. So we had this before. So what we are looking at is, do we know a traded asset on the market? Do we know the stochastic process for this traded asset on the market, given our model? So can we define the stochastic process of a traded asset in terms of our model parameters? Then if I write down the stochastic process for this martingale, the coefficient in front of the dt has to be zero. And then if this guy is a function of my model quantities, which is here my li, then this means that if I apply E2 to it, maybe the drift appears on the right-hand side. And from that condition that the N relative prices are martingales, so from that condition that the drift is zero, maybe I can derive then how this mu I looks like. So we already had this, for example, for the quanto, when we derived the quanto adjustment, where then the mu I turned out to be a function of the sigma i's. So the following derivation also holds for the general case of the stochastic volatility model. And so I will drop a little bit here this dependency on the Li, and I will just write sigma I of t. So let's derive the drift under the terminal measure. So what's the terminal measure? The terminal measure is a special choice of the numerator. So since my time discretization is actually ending at capital Tn, so my tenor discretization looks like that. So capital Tn is here the last point in my time discretization, in my tenor discretization. So I choose here the capital Tn to be the maturity of a zero Cooper bond. So I choose that maturity zero Cooper bond as my numerator, so the zero Cooper bond that matures at the end of my time discretization, at my time horizon. So this is the terminal measure. So I write down here the SDE under this measure, and I would like to know how does mu i under that measure look like. Okay, so this is a nice numerator because all the other zero Cooper bonds, they will cease to exist. Yeah, if you have a zero Cooper bond that has maturity here, it will mature once the time discretization has reached this point. But this zero Cooper bond is alive until the final time, capital Tn. So it's maybe a nice choice of a numerator. And maybe at this point you think, okay, could there be another nice choice? That is maybe the guy. We already know that, for example, the forward rate for the last period, so the forward rate that resides here, has drift zero. So we already know that mu n minus one, so the forward rate for the period from Tn minus one to Tn, this guy is zero. So we already know that this guy is a martingale from our Black model. But of course, we do not know all the other guys. Well, it's not guaranteed that these guys are martingales. Yeah, they are a ratio of traded assets, but the guy that is in the denominator is not our numerator. So we do the same approach. Do we know ratios of traded assets divided by my numerator? So my numerator is the zero Cooper bond that matures in Tn. So let's construct now relative prices with respect to this guy. And what traded assets do we know? Well, we only know here maybe the zero Cooper bonds. So let's construct relative prices of zero Cooper bonds divided by my numerator. So this guy here is my numerator. Well, PTI divided by PTN, I can write this as a telescope sum, PTK divided by PTK plus one, taking the product from K equals I to N minus one. And you know that this here is just from our definition. One plus the forward rate LK times the period TK plus one minus TK. So that's just the forward rate. So the nice thing is that I can express now this ratio as a function of the forward rate from this definition of the forward rate. So we have here this nice product, and I will now write delta K for the period length. So that was a remark here on the previous slide. So maybe I didn't mention that. Okay, to shorten notation, I will now write here delta I for the period length Ti to Ti plus 1. So I know that the drift of this guy here is 0. Yeah? So this guy is a martingale. So the drift of this is 0. That means the stochastic process, if I take the differential of this stochastic process, it is some 0 dt plus something dw. Okay, so where dw is now maybe just the symbol that contains all the dwi. So I know that the drift of this is 0. So let's check how this looks like. Okay, so let's use Ito's lemma to check how this drift looks like. So I apply Ito's lemma, or you could also say I apply the product rule. Well, the product rule now for a general product, so for multiple products, but if you just remember the product rule for two factors, so it's dx times y is y dx plus x dy plus, because we have stochastic processes, dx dy. So what happens in the product rule is that from the product, you differentiate one guy, and the remaining part is the product without that guy. So that means I differentiate one guy. So differentiating one such guy is d applied to this stuff here is delta j dlj. If I just differentiate now one of these guys, the j, and the remaining product stays in front. So that's here just the remaining product. Okay, so I have the remaining product and I just differentiate one guy from the product. And then of course I have the sum over all these factors where I just differentiate one factor and the remaining factors stay in front. So I have of course here the sum. So you see there's a sum here and there's a sum here. The sum over all factors where a factor has been differentiated, and in the remaining product, the differentiating factor is missing. So these are all the first order terms. Then I have the second order terms. Yeah, and in the second order terms, you of course differentiate both parts from the second order. So I differentiate one factor, say factor j, and I differentiate another factor, say I differentiate now factor l. And then in the product, the factor l and the factor j are missing because I have differentiated these guys. And then I take the sum over all such combinations, L and J, of my factors. And here you see I only take all the combinations where L is larger than J. Of course, you cannot differentiate L equal J. You cannot differentiate a single factor twice because that guy is then missing. Yeah? You see this here is, there's no dx dx, yeah, it's a dx dy. So it's L not equal j, but due to symmetry, differentiating dl dj is the same as differentiating dj dl, dlj dll. So because of symmetry, I only have to look at half of this matrix. If you include all combinations, there is the one half in front here. No? So that's here just our product rule. Okay, so that's just the product rule for general product, yeah, of multiple factors. That looks complicated. But now you see that there's always the product here, where from the product, one factor had been removed. And there's the product here, the original product, where from the product, two factors have been removed, namely the two factors which I'm differentiating. So if I just add these two factors to the product, then I can move the whole product in front. So you see, I can move the whole product in front. If I divide for the second order term by the corresponding 1 plus delta L LL and by the 1 plus delta J LJ, because that is just the part that corresponds to here, do not include these two guys in this product. And the same for the other product, where I just remove here the 1 plus delta J LJ, which was not in this product here. So this is just a very simple step of moving here these brackets with the product in front. And apart from that, you have the same expression. Yeah? So nothing has happened. Okay, then you see that I have here a sum over j from I to n minus 1. And here I have a sum, a double sum, j from I to n minus 1, the same sum, and then sum L from I, but L larger than j, to n minus 1. So you can move here this sum in front. If you move also here this double sum, so this one goes from j to n minus 1 in front, and the remaining sum that you have here is L is larger than J and smaller than N minus 1. Yeah, smaller or equal N minus 1, because N minus 1 is included. So that's the remaining part of this double sum. So let me maybe copy here just this double sum. So this double sum here is the sum j from I to n minus 1, so that could be moved in front. And then I have the sum L from I, but L has to be larger than j, so L larger than j and smaller than n minus 1, L smaller or equal n minus 1. Okay, so maybe a small remark. Yeah, I really write this here as a condition with larger or equal, because later you will see that it may happen that j is already n minus 1, and then this sum here is empty. Yeah? This case would also be here, yeah, where the sum is empty. Well, that's the reason why I use this notation. Okay, so nothing has happened on this slide. I just applied the product rule to this guy, of which I know that the guy in front of the dt is zero. And I simplified a little bit the expression, yeah, maybe in a nice way. I know that the dt part of this here is zero, and this here is just a factor where no differential occurs. Yeah. So you see the differentials are here, here, and here. These are the differentials. So actually the condition that dt has a coefficient zero also holds if you just drop this guy here. So I know that now the drift of the left-hand side is zero. Hence, I know that the drift of the right-hand side is zero. And I know that this guy doesn't matter. You know? So the drift of this stuff here has to be zero. Yeah, also note by my condition, yeah, that the interest rates do not touch here. So the bound minus one divided by delta k. So this stuff here is always larger than zero. So I know that the drift of the stuff which is inside here has to be zero. So the drift of this sum has to be zero, or the sum of the drifts has to be zero. So you can even move this sum here in front. And I have this nice condition. So I have this condition that the drift of this sum, or the sum of the drifts, which is the same, is zero. I have it for all I from zero to n minus one. Okay, why is that? Because I just started here with looking at an arbitrary I, an arbitrary financial product, so my zero Cooper bond, with I ranging from zero to n. So there was always here I from zero to n. I have this condition for the drift for all zero Cooper bonds, so for all I. So if you have this for all I, observe that the I only occurs at a single point, namely at this sum. Okay, so there's no I here inside, right? This is just J and L, and this is just a condition on L, which depends on J. So I have that the sum of these drifts is zero for all I. So I can start with I equals n minus one. And I see that the drift of this expression, where I is equal to n minus one and j is equal to I, so the drift of this condition where j is equal to n minus one is zero. And then I can move on to the next point. I already know that the other drift is zero. So the drift part, so the other sum, so the other summation part is zero. So the guy for j equals n minus one. So I already know that that guy is zero. So I know that also j equals, sorry, this is n minus two. So I move on to I equals n minus two. And then I know that also j equals n minus 2, this part here has drift 0, because the part with j equals n minus 1 is already known to be 0. So I have a sum of several parts, and I can now check for each part that the drift of each individual part is 0. So I can actually drop this sum here in front and just write down that this holds for all j. So I have now as a next step that for all j, the drift of this expression is zero. Yeah? So drift always means I just look at the coefficient in front of the dt part. Yeah, now it has been simplified a lot. Yeah, let's plug in now the definition for the differentials. So the definition for the differentials are now, so what do I have here? I have here a dj. The dj is the mu dt plus sigma dw, all with a j. So mu j dt plus sigma j dw j. So I plug that in. And here I have the product of dj dl, but dj dl is just sigma j sigma l rho l j dt. No? Because we know that something dt times something dt is zero, something dt times something dw is zero, dt dt is zero, dt dw is zero. So the only thing that is left is my sigma j dwj sigma l dwl, but wj dwj dwl was my rho jl dt. That was my correlation assumption. Okay, so I just plugged this in, and you see that we will get for the dt parts the mu j here. So this guy will give me the mu j multiplied with delta j divided by 1 plus delta j lj, this guy. And in the sum, I get delta j delta l, and I get here the sigma j sigma l rho jl as replacement for the dlj dll. So that has to be zero. So I know that this is zero. So this is the coefficient in front of the dt. So I know that this has to be zero. So this here is the coefficient of the dt part. So the drift is zero, so this guy is zero. So if this is zero, actually you see there's a common factor. You can cancel that one here. The delta j divided by 1 plus delta j lj. Wow, and now it's nice, yeah, because you just have mu plus some covariance term is zero. So I just move the stuff to the other side. Mu is minus this sum here of the covariance with some factor. So we have a very nice expression for the drift. So the drift under the terminal measure is this expression minus the sum L larger or equal J plus 1, smaller or equal N minus 1, delta L divided by 1 plus delta L LL, then the instantaneous covariance. So the covariance between the interest rate which you look at, for which you define the drift, and some future interest rate. Okay, so some L, where L is actually here in the future. So if you have a time discretization, okay, so that's my time discretization, then I have here the interest rate for which I look up the drift. Yeah, so maybe that's this guy here. This is now the rate for which you look up the drift. And you see L is a sum that starts at J plus 1. So that's here T J plus 1. So this sum is running over all these interest rates that are here in the future. And it is looking at the covariances of these guys with respect to my current rate. And you also see that if this guy here moves to the end, if this guy moves to the end, the sum will become shorter. The sum will become shorter. Actually, it's negative. So if this covariance here is positive, it will become larger because it was more negative before. The sum will become shorter. And if it has reached the end, the last one, actually, this is an empty sum. This is zero. So we can also just verify that mu n minus 1 is 0. Okay, under our terminal measure. We are here under the terminal measure. Okay. So let's complete this session. Yeah, maybe I just have 5 minutes, but let's complete this session by deriving the drift term under another measure, the spot measure. And the spot measure is the measure which we already know where we perform this successive reinvestment. So it's the rolled over one period bond. You remember that. So where we have initially an investment of one unit of currency, and then we invest always in the bond that matures at the end of the next period. And the bond that matures at the end of the next period, so this successive reinvestment. Okay, the bond that matures at the end of the next period is PTMT plus one, where MT plus one is the index corresponding to the end of the period at which little t is. So that's here maybe my little t. And then this guy is here my Tm of t plus one. And I'm investing now here in the bond that matures, or I'm invested in the bond that matures at the end of the period. And what you have before here, so all the stuff that is before here, is just the investment that you have accumulated. And we already know that this is just a product of one plus the forward rate at that time when the forward rate was starting, yeah, at the beginning of the period of the forward rate, accumulated over time. So let's take this as a numerator. This is also a very nice numerator because it lives for the whole time. Yeah. Sure, our numerator has to live over the whole time. And in contrast to the terminal measure, there's also a nice property for this numerator because it doesn't know anything about the time horizon. It can go on and on and on. So that's maybe... that's maybe the nice guy for a numerator. Also a very popular numerator. The corresponding measure is called the spot measure. So how do we derive now the drift? Okay, that is exactly the same. And maybe I can then jump a little bit through this. We just look again at traded asset at relative prices. So I have my numerator here below and I have a relative price. So I look at n relative prices of zero coupon bonds. So the bond that matures at TI divided by my numerator. So that's here the bond that matures at TI divided by the bond that matures at the end of the next period multiplied with the amount accumulated over time. Well, one divided by, okay, so there's the 2^-1 here. Yeah, that looks a bit difficult because here I have an object that is actually not modeled by my model, the bond that matures at the end of the period. But the funny thing is that this object is also inside of this guy, and the ratio here of the two, the ratio is just the forward rates on my time discretization. So the reason why that is the case is that this ratio of the bond depends on the maturities. And here I have a maturity, the end of the next period, starting at the end of the next period, ending in TI. So these define here the starting and end point in my product. So I have that this stuff here will give me this product of the forward rates LJ 1 plus LJ delta J. But now it is 1 divided by, because the bond with the larger maturity is on top, the bond with the smaller maturity is on the bottom. Before it was the other way around. So it is 1 divided by in this product. And if I is the time where I look at the financial product, now the product runs from the current time, so the end of the period where the current time is, to I. So it doesn't run into the future. It's actually everything that is before TI. It's from M of T plus 1 to I minus 1. Okay, so that's here just a constant. So the drift of this is 0. If the drift of this guy is 0, well, you see there is an M, a T here, but you, if you differentiate this, actually this is just the index that corresponds to the end of the period, and the guys are smoothly connected, yeah? So you do not need to differentiate this here. So I just have to look at this part here. And let me, because time's up, just go quickly through this. You see, you differentiate now again a product, and there's only one difference compared to the previous derivation. It is a 1 divided by here. And of course, the sum here or the product runs over different indices. So you apply again the trick that you can drop this part here. You do not need to differentiate this part here. And then I just apply again the product rule. Due to this 1 divided by, I get here a more complicated expression, because I have to differentiate it to 1 divided by, which gives me 1 divided by the squared plus 1 divided by power of 3. You get the same here in the second order part. This is the dx dy. Yeah. Okay. So the thing is that you can now move again this product in front and just divide by the factors which you have added. And you can drop this part. And then you have the condition that, again, the drift of the sum of these expressions here is 0. Okay, and the only difference is that the sums run a little bit different. Yeah, so now from mt plus 1 to I minus 1, and L is between mt and j. Okay, and then comes a similar simplification step, and you on then comes the same step that we plug in the definition of the stochastic process and get a very similar expression now for the mu, where the sum runs over a different set of indices, namely from the past, and the minus has been changed to a plus, which comes from differentiating 1 divided by. So you see there's here a plus in front. Okay, so maybe we can repeat this, because the spot measure is a little bit important. We can repeat this in the beginning of the next session. Yeah? And then we have completed the derivation of the drift. Yeah, because here I just have stating another version, which is a combination of the two measures. And then we will discuss a little bit what is the issue with this short period bond that is actually missing in our model. Okay, so that was it for today. Thanks.